Hi children, welcome to Jairam High Secondary School online classes. This is a video from class 8 biology unit 6 microorganisms. Hope children you all have viewed the previous parts of this lesson, part 1 and part 2. So in that video we have discussed about the different classes of microorganisms such as virus, bacteria, fungi, algae and protozoa. We also seen about the shapes, structure, characteristics, nutrition and reproduction of virus, bacteria, fungi, algae and protozoa. Hope you all have seen this videos, and today in this video we'll move on to the uses of microorganisms. So we already know microorganisms are the smallest living organisms ever known in this world. They are also a group of living organisms which cannot be seen with our naked eye. Microorganisms can be seen only with the help of a microscope. So these tiny organisms, even though they cause a variety of diseases in plants, animals and human beings, they prove to be very much beneficial for human beings also. Actually, they are very much useful in our day-to-day life. Even for simple example, we can say milk, it is turning into a curd. So how the milk is turning into curd? That is also due to the action of a bacteria called as lactobacillus. Okay, so that curd proved to be a very nutritious, protein rich diet in our food. Okay, so this kind of microorganisms, they increase the dietary content of the food also, so they increase the nutrition also. So like this, they prove to be very much useful to us. So in this video we'll see about the beneficial effects of microorganisms. The first use in the medicine, in the field of medicine, it is used in the production of antibiotics. So what is antibiotic? Suppose if you suffer from fever or a common cold, what you will do? You normally go to a doctor. The doctor will analyze what kind of disease you have by asking you about the symptoms. So based upon the symptoms, the doctor will come to a conclusion what kind of disease you are affected by. So based upon that, he will give an antibiotic in the form of either injection or syrup or in the form of tablet. So these tablet, syrup and injection, these are called antibiotic. Antibiotics are given once when the person is affected by the disease. So it is given in order to get rid of the disease. So it is also given to kill the microorganism which is causing that kind of particular disease. Okay, so this is called antibiotic. So the term antibiotic, bio means living, it is produced from a living organism, and anti means against. So substance produced by the living organisms which is toxic for other living organisms is called as antibiotics. For example, the substance produced by a microorganism is proved to be very harmful to other microorganism. So this thing we are utilizing in the production of antibiotics. This was first discovered by the great scientist Sir Alexander Fleming. So you can see in the picture. So this person, he was the first person to discover the antibiotic called penicillin in the year 1928. During this time, it was a time of World War II, and during that time many soldiers got injured, and due to the injury they were affected by many diseases due to the entry of microorganisms through their injuries. So in order to get rid of that, Sir Alexander Fleming, he discovered an antibiotic penicillin, and this proves to be very harmful variety of microorganisms. So this is called a broad spectrum antibiotic, which means it can be given to many kind of diseases. So he was the first person to discover antibiotic, and this penicillin is got from the fungus Penicillium chrysogenum. So we already discussed about the fungus. It is a group of microorganisms which lack chlorophyll. Okay, it follows the heterotrophic mode of nutrition. So this fungus, one kind of fungus is Penicillium chrysogenum. So from this only he got penicillin, an antibiotic, and this penicillin is used to treat various diseases like tetanus, diphtheria, etc. So tetanus and diphtheria are the names of diseases and these diseases can be treated using the antibiotic called penicillin. So likewise, there is one more antibiotic called streptomycin, and this is also a broad spectrum antibiotic, which means this antibiotic can be used to treat a variety of other diseases. This is also got from the bacteria called streptomyces, and this streptomycin is used to treat plague. So in the field of medicine, microorganisms are useful in the production of antibiotics. You just think of that, if there is no antibiotic, will we get from a cure for any other diseases? No. So you will not get cure from any other diseases. Even though at present our scientists all over the world, they are also fighting against the disease called as COVID-19. It is due to a group of coronavirus, you know very well. So the scientists are fighting to get rid of the coronavirus, and they are finding ways to get rid of the coronavirus, and they are finding medicines. So this medicine is nothing but which is used to get cure from the particular diseases. Okay, so this is called antibiotic. So next comes the vaccines. So we know very well, day to day life, in our daily life, we are hearing the news that by the month of August, we will be getting vaccines for COVID-19. So what does this vaccines means? So vaccines, since antibiotic, they are given once when the disease occurred, but the vaccines are given before the onset of the disease. It is given to prevent the disease. For example, you are very, very well versed in the vaccine called polio vaccine. So the children below the age of 5, they are given free oral polio vaccine, OPV vaccine. So you might be aware of that. So the children, if they are given that vaccines, that will protect them from the disease called polio till their lifetime. Okay, the children will not get affected by the polio disease till their lifetime. So vaccines are the thing which are given before this onset of diseases, and the antibiotic are given after the disease. It is used to cure the disease, but vaccines are given to prevent the disease, prevent the persons from the disease. Okay, now also we got the news that by August 15, we will be getting vaccines for the COVID-19. So it is just to prevent ourselves from the COVID-19 virus. Okay, so vaccines, these are prepared from dead or weakened microbes. So what is this dead or weakened microbes? So these vaccines are nothing but the preparation of the microbes which is causing that particular disease. For example, the poliomyelitis disease vaccine, it is nothing but it contains the poliomyelitis virus. The poliomyelitis virus is the causative organism of the polio disease. We are taking that particular virus itself and we are heat killing that. We are heating it in a high temperature and we are killing it. So in the temperature, the virus will be dead. Okay, it is in a dead condition, but the dead viruses are given into our body. So even though it is dead, it will not cause any kinds of symptoms or any kind of diseases, but the dead organisms are entered inside our body. So our human body have a well-defined immune system. So our immune system will encounter it as an foreign antigen, and it will start producing antibodies to fight against that particular organism, but the organism is dead. So our body will be already producing many kind of antibiotic against that. So if in the future the original polio virus is entering inside our body is already has prepared antibodies to fight against that polio virus. So till our life end, our body will not be affected by the polio virus. So this is the concept of vaccine. So vaccines contains the dead or weakened microbes. Okay, so this concept was first discovered by the scientist Edward Jenner. So here you can see from the picture of Edward Jenner, he was the first person to discover vaccination, and he discovered smallpox vaccine. He was the person to coin the term vaccination. So we are given vaccines even when the child is born. A born child, from the day one, we are starting to give the vaccines, isn't it? So we are giving vaccines in order to prevent the disease till the lifetime. So this vaccination concept was first discovered by Edward Jenner. This procedure is also called as immunization, which is nothing but we are preparing our body, we are preparing our immune system to fight against the disease before it enters inside our body and start to cause any kind of symptoms. Okay, so that is the concept of vaccines. For example, we have MMR vaccine. This triple vasin. This is also called as triple vasin because it contains the vasins for three different diseases like measles, mumps and rubella. These are like chickenpox and smallpox, like these are caused by viruses. Okay, measles, mumps and rubella, these are caused by viruses, and these three diseases can be prevented by giving MMR vaccine. It is also called triple antigen since it contains three kinds of antigen and it can prevent us from three kinds of diseases, so it is called as triple antigen. And we have one more example like BCG vaccine for tuberculosis. You know very well TB is a disease which is affecting the lungs, so BCG is a vaccine. It is given in primary health centers. Bacillus calmette-guerin, that is the name of the vaccine which is given for tuberculosis, prevention of tuberculosis. And one more example is poliomyelitis virus vaccine, which is given to prevent the poliomyelitis diseases, okay, polio diseases. So we have so many kinds of vaccines, and even now all our scientists are, they are working very hard to find a vaccine for this COVID-19 virus also, and very soon we hope that will happen and we will be getting rid of this COVID-19 also. Okay, so these microorganisms and especially the viruses, they are very much helpful in the preparation of vaccines. Okay, next, in the field of agriculture, so microorganisms are naturally present in the soil, we know very well. So in the soil, it is acting as a natural fertilizer. What do you mean by fertilizer? Like if you have a rose plant in your home, what are the things we'll be adding for the rose plant to grow well? We'll be adding that some kind of waste onion leaves, onion peels, and then waste tea decoctions, and some kind of fertilizers also. So these are natural fertilizers. These things will be decomposed in the soil and it will be giving all kinds of nutrients to the plant growth. Okay, so the plant will be growing nicely. So this is called fertilizer. So fertilizers are the things that is added for enriching the nutrients in the soil. So microorganisms, they act as natural fertilizer. They are present in the soil. They help in the growth of the plant. So the microorganisms, they are naturally called as natural decomposers. Why they are called natural decomposers? What do you mean by decomposing? Once when the body of an animal or a plant is dead, it is decomposed. The whole body is broken down into simpler particles, and these simpler particles are replenished in the soil, and again the plants, they utilize these nutrients for their growth, and from the plants again the animals and human beings, they are getting the nutrients, and again if they are dead, again it is returned to the soil. So this is like a cyclic process. Okay, so this is happening due to the presence of soil microorganisms. So microorganism, especially soil bacteria and many kind of fungi, they act as natural decomposers in the soil. If the decomposers are not present in the soil, you think of how our earth would be. Our earth would be a full heap of dead bodies, dead plants and animals. So if at all the microorganisms is not present, the decomposition process will not happen, and the recycling of nutrients in the soil also will not happen. So there will be no nutrients at all in the soil. The nutrients will be easily finished. Okay, so the microorganisms are called as natural decomposers in the soil. So what are the types of nutrients required for the plants, such as nitrates and inorganic nutrients, are released in the soil? These decomposers, such as soil bacteria and fungi, they decompose the dead bodies of plants and animals, and they convert it into nitrates and inorganic nutrients. Okay, again the soil will be made fertile, and once when the soil is fertile, and the plants can easily absorb the nutrients and it can grow well. So this is called as compost. It is also called as compost. So compost is nothing but a natural fertilizer. So in olden days, nowadays only we are using different kinds of decomposing materials, different kinds of recycling processes. But in the previous years, in the olden days, what they used to do in the agriculture field itself, they will have pit means kuli, okay, so they will have a small pit, dig into the soil, and they will put all the kinds of waste in it, like dead leaves, dry leaves and kitchen waste and cow dung and animal waste. So all these kinds of biodegradable substances will put into the pit, and after 2 or 3 weeks they will close the pit, and after 2 or 3 months that will be decomposed and act as a natural fertilizer. So that act as a very good fertilizer, so that is called as compost. And this method of decomposing the waste is called as composting. This is an oldest method, and this compost can be used as a natural fertilizer. So you can see from the picture the various kinds of fertilizers. So bacterial, it is mainly made up of bacterial fertilizer, fungal, algae, aquatic ferns and earthworms. So here they have given examples of rhizobium, acetobacter, azospirillum and psm azolla, cyanobacteria and am fungi. These are all microorganisms and they can act as a very good fertilizers. They can enrich the soil with nutrients. In turn, it will help the plants to grow very well and give good yield and good production. Like this, the microorganisms prove to be very essential in the field of agriculture. Next, nitrogen fixation. So what nitrogen is a gas, we know very well. Like oxygen, carbon dioxide, nitrogen also present in the air, and nitrogen is very much essential for the plant growth. But the plants cannot take nitrogen as it is in the gaseous form. It has to be converted into the form where it is available to the plants. So nitrogen has to be converted in the form of nitrate. So once when it is converted into nitrate only, the plant can easily absorb the nitrate, and is very much useful for the plant growth, because we know very well our base molecule DNA, which is responsible for the inheritance of characters, it is made up of nitrogenous compounds. So nitrogen is very much essential for a plant or a animal growth. So this nitrogen as it is, it cannot be utilized by the plants. It has to be converted in the form of nitrate. So this rhizobium, which is present in the root nodules of leguminous plants. So what do you mean by leguminous plants? Like peas, patani, peas and groundnut. So these are called as leguminous plants. So this nitrobium will be present in the root nodules of these leguminous plants, and they are helpful for the fixing of atmospheric nitrogen, which means the conversion of atmospheric nitrogen, which is in the gaseous form, to nitrate, which is as a soluble form, which can be easily absorbed by the plants. Okay, so this is the process called nitrogen fixation, where the atmospheric nitrogen is converted in the form of nitrate, and only in this form the plants can absorb the nitrate and utilize for its growth. So example, cyanobacteria and nostoc, these are other living organisms apart from rhizobium which are helpful in the process of nitrogen fixation. Okay, so nitrogen fixation is also to enrich the soil with nitrogen, which is mainly helpful for the growth of the plants. So rhizobium is a very best example for nitrogen fixing bacteria. It is a type of rod shaped bacteria, so it is very helpful for nitrogen fixation. And next, biocontrol agents. What do you mean by biocontrol agents? So in the field of agriculture, we have different types of steps involved in agriculture. Like we are first of all ploughing, we are making the soil, so we are making the soil ready. And next we are sowing the seeds, and then we are watering it, then we are manuring it. So even though after doing all the procedures correctly, when the crop is grown, it is very much essential to protect the crop from other animals or pests. When a plant is grown up, if it is affected by the pest, it proves to be very loss to the farmer. The yield is also reduced and the production is also reduced. So even though we follow all the steps correctly, here comes the protection of crops. So protection of crops is a very essential steps in the agriculture field. Okay, so in order to protect the crop from the pest, in the olden days what they used to do, they used to put turmeric or some other natural biocontrol agents. But in nowadays it is not possible, because we are growing in large production. Due to the population increase, we are in a need to produce large in a very small time. So we have to protect the crops from the pest. So one best example is Bacillus thuringiensis BT cotton. It is used to control the insects. And one other example is Trichoderma viridae. It is from fungi. It is present in the roots. It is used to control the plant pathogens. What do you mean by pathogens? The pathogens are the microorganisms which cause disease to the plants. That is called plant pathogens. So in order to protect from plant pathogens, we are using the fungi as a biocontrol agent. And even though virus also can be used as a biocontrol agent, for example, baculovirus. So these kind of viruses, it can prevent it from the insects which attacks or from any kind of arthropods. Arthropods are also, it's a kind of insects. So baculovirus can protect the plant from any kinds of insects. Okay, so these are some examples which act as an biocontrol agents. So here in the picture we have given how the biocontrol agents will work. For example, Bacillus thuringiensis, it is a bacteria, and from this a gene is removed. So the gene which is responsible for killing that particular kind of insects, the gene which is producing the toxic substance against that particular kind of insect which is affecting the crop. Okay, clear? This insect is affecting the crop. This insect is feeding upon this crop. So since it is feeding upon this crop, it naturally the crop is getting damaged. So in order to protect the crop from this insect, we have discovered a new toxin which is present in Bacillus thuringiensis. So the toxin producing gene alone, we are taking it and we are inserting it into the plant itself. And when these insects come and feed upon the plant, automatically the toxin, the gene will produce the toxin, and the toxin will kill the insect. So by this method, we can avoid the other animals also which is being affected when we are spraying some kinds of insecticide or pesticide. Normally, you can see they are spraying, some persons are spraying that pesticides, insecticides on the plants. This is also a non-biodegradable substance and which cause many kinds of pollution also. So in order to prevent the other animals, birds and insects from dying, we are using this insecticide gene control method as a biocontrol agents. So here also the microorganisms are proved to be very useful in protecting the crop from the pest. So the microorganisms are acting as a biocontrol agents and in the field of industry. So how the microorganisms are used in the field of industry? First, in the process of sewage treatment. So what do you mean by sewage? The waste is called as a sewage, the waste water. Once after use, the water once after use, it becomes a waste. So that waste water is called as a sewage. So this aerobic microbes, what do you mean by aerobic microbes? The microorganisms which can grow in the presence of oxygen, that is called aerobic microbes. These aerobic microbes, they are added to the effluent in the secondary stage of sewage treatment. So in sewage treatment, we have three different stages: primary, secondary and tertiary treatment. So in the secondary stage, we are adding these aerobic microbes. So these microbes, they consume the organic matter present in the sewage and it decomposes it and it convert into the non-toxic form. For example, Nitrobacter and Methanobacterium. These two bacterium are used in the sewage treatment process. And next, in the production of biogas, the same sewage treatment, we are using some kind of anaerobic bacteria. So this is just contracts to anaerobic bacteria which can grow in the absence of oxygen. So these kind of anaerobic bacteria, for example, is methanogens. So these are used in the production of biogas. They can decompose the human and animal fecal and plant waste, and they are converted into biogas. And this biogas is used as an efficient fuel for other purposes. Okay. Next thing, production of alcohol and wine. You know very well, yeast is a unicellular fungi which is used in the fermentation process. So fermentation is nothing but breaking down of glucose into lactic acid with the evolution of carbon dioxide. So once when the carbon dioxide is getting evolved, it makes the food substances soft and fluffy. So it is used in the fermentation process. It is also used in the baking and brewing industry in the making of bread. Okay, and fermentation, this process also used in the production of alcohol and wine. So yeast is an anaerobic organism. It grows in the absence of oxygen, and this is an unicellular fungi. It contains a single cell and it comes under the category of fungus. So this yeast is used in the fermentation process, conversion of glucose directly into lactic acid with the evolution of carbon dioxide. So it is also used in bread and bread making industry. Then microbes in retting and tanning. So rating process, flax plants, it is tied into bundle and it is kept in water. The flax plants are used for jute production. Okay, these are tied in a bundle and they are kept in water. And when the bacteria is added upon to that, this bacteria will loosen the tissues present in the flax plants. So this is used in linen production. The best example is Pseudomonas aeruginosa. This is an example of a bacteria, Pseudomonas aeruginosa. This is an example of a bacteria which is used in the rating process. This is mainly to loosening the tissues and used in the production of linen. Next, the tanning process. This tanning process is mainly used in the leather industries. So leather comes from the skin of animals, we know very well. So the skin of animals, once when it is removed as it is, we cannot use converted into a leather. Before that, it should be processed, it should be made soft. So in order to make it soft and pliable, bacteria are added to the skin of animals, and these bacteria will loosen the tissues of the animals and make it very soft. So this process is called as tanning. So tanning is the process used in the leather industries. Next, in daily life, in our day-to-day life, how the microorganisms proves to be very beneficial. So as we saw in the previous video, yeast is used in the making of bread. So yeast, it is used to the bread softness and fluffiness of a bread is used to the presence of yeast. And chlorella is kind of algae. This is also very much rich in proteins, and this chlorella is used in food as when in space. So in a space, they will not eat food as we are eating. So this chlorella is used in the form of tablets in the food in the space in preparation of curd and cheese. So daily in our day-to-day life, we are seeing the preparation of curd. So the turning of milk into curd is due to the presence of a bacteria called lactobacillus bacteria. It turns the lactose is nothing but the milk sugar, it is present in the milk, to lactic acid. So due to the formation of lactic acid only, the milk is turning into curd. The tasteness of the curd is somewhat different from that of the milk. So this is also due to the conversion of lactose to lactic acid, and is also used in the formation of paneer from curd. Okay, next, in human intestine. So normally in our human intestine itself, we have a bacteria called lactobacillus acidophilus, which is helpful for the digestion of food and fight against harmful microorganisms. And we have a microorganism called E. coli, Escherichia coli. It's a kind of bacteria. It can synthesize vitamin B and vitamin K in our human intestine itself. So these two bacteria do not prove to be any harmful to the humans. It is naturally present in our human intestine, and it proves to be beneficial to us also. So these are the uses of microorganisms. So we have seen the various uses of microorganisms, such as, first of all, it is used in the field of medicine in the production of antibiotics. Antibiotics are the substances used to cure a particular diseases. It is given once after the onset of the diseases. Next, it is used in the preparation of vaccines. So vaccines are the prepared from dead or weakened microbes. They are the preparations of the microorganisms itself which is causing the disease. So these are given to protect us from the onset of diseases. And in agriculture, it is used as natural fertilizer to enrich the soil with nutrients. And next, it is used in the nitrogen fixation, in the conversion of atmospheric nitrogen into the soluble form nitrate. And it is also used as a biocontrol agent to protect the crops from pesticides. So in industry, it is used in sewage treatment process and in the production of biogas, in production of alcohol and wine, and it is used in rating and tanning process. And in our day-to-day life, it is used in the making of bread, preparation of curd and cheese, and is also normally it is present in human intestine. It is used to synthesize vitamin B and vitamin K. So these are the beneficial effects of microorganisms. So microorganisms proves to be very much useful to living beings. So not only they cause disease, they are also very much beneficial to us. So children, in this video we have seen the beneficial effects of microorganisms. Hope you all have understood the video. In the next video, we will continue with the harmful effects of microorganisms. So keep watching, keep listening. Thank you. Have a nice day.